The William W. Hay Railroad Seminar Series is sponsored by the National University Rail Center here at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. On behalf of all of us, we thank the USDOT for their ongoing support. It is greatly appreciated by those of us here on campus, as well as those participating by the Internet. Let me also welcome those of you who are joining us via the Internet, which includes representatives from Kimikata Rail Consulting, Amtrak, Metra, Sharma & Associates, Federal Transit Administration, LTK Engineering, Parsons Brinkerhoff, HNTB, Patrick Engineering, Hatchmont McDonald, Railstar Engineering, Illinois Department of Transportation, TUV Rail Sciences, Canadian Pacific, Sistra Consulting, BNSF Railway, and Hanson Professional Services. We greatly appreciate your participation via the Internet. I guess I should say one add one thing. For those of you participating via the Internet or in person, if you would like to receive PDH credits for your participation, please send an email to Emma Ehrenhardt, as indicated in the announcement for the seminar. So the purpose of positive train control, or PTC as it's widely referred to in the United States, is to provide a safe, interoperable environment for trains operating on the railroads. However, its implementation is not free of challenges for railroads and its corresponding certification by FRA. Europe has experienced related challenges with the development of their version of PTC, what's known as the European Rail Traffic Management System, or ERTMS, and the European Train Control System, or ETCS. These systems are also intended to provide similar benefits for both conventional and high-speed rail systems in Europe. Part of the process is certifying their proper functionality and reliability before they're put into use. Italcertifer is one of the several firms that is authorized to assess and certify railway systems in Europe, and they've been extensively involved with the certification of several ERTMS and ETCS systems in Europe and worldwide. Our speaker today is highly qualified to address this topic. Marco Eibenschutz completed his BS degree in aeronautical engineering at the University of Rome, La Sapienza, in 1990. In 2000, he began working with the Italian railways as an independent safety assessor. His area of specialization with Italcertifer is signaling and control, specifically with the ERTMS ETCS Level 2 system. He has worked on three different ERTMS projects in Italy, as well as three others in the Czech Republic, China, and Australia. Please join me in welcoming our speaker today, Mr. Marco Eibenschutz, who will present the William Hay Railroad Engineering Seminar entitled ERTMS, ETCS, Level 2, Issues and Challenges in the Certification Process. But before Mr. Eibenschutz starts, his colleague, Maria Taiti, who is the marketing and sales manager with Italcertifer, is going to give a brief introduction to the company, because there's nothing quite like this in the United States, and so we thought it would be helpful for you to understand where Italcertifer fits into the larger railway picture in Europe. So I'll turn it over to Maria.
Thank you very much for Chris and to the University of Illinois, who gave us these great opportunities. Okay. Italcertifer is a company belonging to Italian Railways Group, and we provide services like certification, testing, laboratories, design verification and training since 2001. This is our participation to the Italian railway state. Okay, and this is Italcertifer is part of it. Our other shareholders are the University of Pisa, the University of Florence, the Polytechnical of Milan, and the Polytechnical of Naples. These are the main universities in Italy. Our technical skills for safety are in rail operation, signaling, energy, infrastructure, rolling stock and maintenance, all that is deal with railway world, okay? This is Italcertifer presence in the world. As Marco will explain to you, we have a really interesting project in Australia, which is dealing with driverless system, a GPS. In any case, we have other contracts around the world, even for the California Speed Rail Authority, a really short contract by UIC in Europe, to understand something. In any case, we have a good business in Europe for the high-speed project, but even for wagons, okay, and signaling systems. Okay, now I'll leave the words. I leave you in the hands of Marco. Okay. This is our main clients, Alstom, Ansaldo STS, Bombardier, GE, and the other, Fevele, other main, these are our testing laboratories, which we have two main laboratories. One in Florence for rolling stock. Every bench is for testing rolling stock. And we have two machines that test rolling stocks online, okay, for measurement, etc. And another big lab in Rome for testing infrastructure and new technologies. This is our last challenge, a really good world record. We have certified the high-speed rolling stock in Italy in only eight months, testing and certification, okay? And this is only a short film. It's to show you how is the our behavior in the testing line. This is our president. I wake up, feel just fine. Your face fills my mind. This is our labs in Florence. And now I really live in the hands of Marco.
No, I've got my thingy. Okay, now, nice to meet you all. I'm speaking English, which is not my language, so, you know, if you don't understand, if I'm not clear enough, please ask me to repeat. Then, you know, what am I supposed to do here? Basically, this is not going to be, I think, a university lesson. What I want to do is share with you, especially the students, my experience of my last 15 years, which on the one hand for a student clarifies why he has to spend so many time in school studying absurd things and how these things then in the end turn useful. But another thing which I really think is valuable is that I come from Italy, a European country. Since the beginning of the millennium, there was a big revolution in railways, which we like to call high speed. This sudden change, which is basically a regulation and technological shift, had an enormous impact on the life of every single member of Europe. Because, you know, if you asked me 20 years ago, what is a train? Well, it's a kind of machine. You buy a ticket, you sit on it, and invariably you get, if you get somewhere, incredibly late. So, but that's the truth, because that's exactly what I thought about the railways when I started this job. So, you know, you would, for medium distance, which for me is 500, 600 kilometers, I would fly or I would drive a car. I would never dream of getting on a train. Basically, the train was something for people in the army who had to go back to the barracks or people who could not afford a car. Then something changed. The picture at the beginning of year 2000 was to have, I don't know, 28 European different countries, each one with its own railway system, which was the same but different from the other, meaning the signal is always red, yellow, and green, but some are like this, some are like that, some are flashing. And there was no integration between the systems, no standardization, and especially very high cost, because there was no global market. Because, you know, I would make an interlocking only for the Italian railways, then another company. At a certain point, this strange federal institution, which is the EU, decided to issue a new signaling standard, which had to be adopted by all the countries in the EU. This signaling standard works, in the end, on the same principles, meaning you have a rail. When the train shunts, it means that the train behind gets a red signal. It's just the mechanism of how this information is, I would say, crunched, elaborated, and the way it's transmitted to the train is slightly different from the traditional systems. Basically, all this information travels by radio signal. You know, in the end, this is an irrelevant technical detail, but from the point of view of infrastructure managers, it means reducing the cost of installation, which in the end is not that important, but of maintaining track circuits are still there, but coded current systems, signals, because in high speed, you got travel on the track and there's no signal, no nothing. So the idea was to reduce as much as possible the costs and generate a standard. Now, you might wonder, okay, why is this chap here in America talking to us about high-speed trains? In this country, we have freight trains. Why should we be interested in that? The answer I can give you is a magic word, which is interoperability, which means a local with a driver which has been trained by a certain company should be able to travel with that train on all the national lines, or even better, on the continental lines, without having to change logo, change driver, and so on. So, and the other thing, which I'm not sure, but I guess is the same, I suppose that in the States you have signaling principles that are more or less the same, but each railway infrastructure manager is company has got slightly different rules. These rules, on the one hand, are very nice because they don't let your competitors to run on your line. So there is a technical reason. But on the other hand, this small advantage is paid at enormous maintenance costs, which I think are rather relevant. At this point, what I will show in the presentation is is the experience I had in life. Sometimes you have a stroke of luck. I happened to surf the right wave just by chance, meaning that in 2003, I started working as a safety assessor on the first Italian high-speed line. At the time, we had the standard, which is based on what we call Unisig standards, which say how the train how the track side speaks on board, vice versa, how you convey the information. And what we found out, of course, is that that standard did not work. I mean, I don't want to say that, but as usual, I want to overstress things. But I mean, that standard, and this is why I appreciate it now, is like a programming language. It's like C++, Java. It's a way you convey information. It doesn't tell you how to process it or what to do, which, I mean, if in a country the section that has to be free in front of the train has to be 2,000 meters, and in another country is 5,000, it doesn't make any difference to the system. And especially it does not make any difference to the driver, which is what matters. The driver sees the information he needs, which is a needle on what I call the speedometer that tells you the speed at which the train is supposed to drive. Another thing, and then I'll get into the... For me, as a European, something which is absolutely not conceivable is that the safety of a train is in the hands only of the driver. Because, of course, all the drivers are extremely qualified, but they're humans. You know, think I am an aeronautical engineer. So the chain of events that leads to an accident is very clear to me. For me, it's inconceivable that the train has not got an ATP system, an automatic train protection system. If the driver makes a mistake, if there is some fault somewhere in the chain, the system has to prevent the train to go in overspeed. Well, overspeed can be any speed from 0 to 300 for me. I will tell you my experience, what we found out, and then ironically how this experience of high-speed trains on high-capacity lines, you must think in Europe, we have relatively small countries and lots of people traveling by train, which is not exactly your problem. But on the other hand, this experience on high-speed trains turned incredibly useful for freight trains, driverless trains, other applications. Now, let's go ahead. This is Italy. This is just, I have no idea what is written there. It gives an idea of the extent of the lines in Italy. So in we have a network of 16,703 kilometers, which, you know, it's respectable for a small country. It's nothing special. 7,000 is double track, single track is 9,000 kilometers. Basically, in Italy, we have overhead power supply on most of the major lines. Unfortunately for us, we are not in Illinois. Italy is not flat. It's full of mountains, it's full, and since trains don't like to climb up, we have to dig a lot of tunnels or build bridges, so we have a lot of these, lots of stations. Then we have, let's say, two signaling technologies. One is the historical signaling technology, which is SCMT, which is very reliable, very common technology. And now, after a bit, it starts to work too. And then we have this thing, which is the high speed. What is the difference from these two systems? this system is what I call a legacy system. It's a system which was, I'm sorry, I'm an engineer, so I have to think in terms of boxes, otherwise I can't. This system was what I call a system built bottom up, meaning I've got my legacy system, then somebody from the railway says, ooh, shall we add this? So a system, it has grown with the years to increase performance, safety, and so on, but in a very, not in an organical way, because you always had to cope with what was present there, and you had to make compromises, which made the system incredibly expensive, which is not nice. Why I'm saying all these things? Because probably in the States, you will have the same kind of problem. So at a certain point, you will have to install, upgrade the PTC, and you will have to decide an approach. You know, you can go from A to B in several ways. There is not the best way, but you must be able to choose the way you want, not being given whatever happens. This system instead, which is the high speed, is a system designed according to what I studied at university. System design first, top down, and this approach proved incredibly useful, because basically with this top down designing system, the people who designed that built some basic building blocks, which I called, we all played with Lego, are the Lego building blocks. These building blocks are standard, meaning there are some interfaces, some ways to communicate, but can be connected in different ways and can do different things. This is what I found out later. Let's see. Of course, sorry, I forgot to say that we have 1,000 kilometers of high-speed lines that basically go from Salerno, that is here, to Rome, that is where I live, up to Milan and Turin. Let's see what's next. Okay. As I said, where did it come, all of this? Came from an idea of the EU to have an interoperable system with corridors, so that without, I call them backbones. Basically, you should be able to move from A to B on these lines, having a common standard and so on. This, you know, from a passenger point of view, I don't see much of a point in commuting to Copenhagen by train. Despite in China, I learned that sometimes it's very useful to have a train to travel 2,000 kilometers. Depends on the number of, it's obvious, depends on the number of passengers you have. If you have to carry 2,000 passengers with a head, you can't use an aeroplane. You must use a train, even if the distance is 2,000 kilometers. And this is Beijing, Shanghai, as somebody knows very well in the audience. But these corridors are basically meant not really for high-speed train, but for freight trains. Why do we don't have space. So why do you have to make goods travel around Europe in lorries, or trucks as you call them, polluting, generating accidents and so on, while once you just use the rail? And here, having a standard is something extremely useful. In fact, the ETCS system, it's called High Speed, High Capacity System. The idea behind it is, at the beginning, we let the passengers travel. And this actually made a big difference for the railway companies, because if you travel fast, you can charge more for the tickets. So now, high speed is big business. I'll tell you, you know, I work here, I live here. I work in Naples, I work in Florence, I work in Milan. You know, Rome-Florence is 300 kilometers. Rome-Milan is 500. Nowadays, thanks to high-speed train, I get up a little bit early, I get a 6 o'clock train, after 3 hours, I live from the center of Rome, go to the center of Milan, have my business meeting, and then get back to the station, faint on the train with a beer, and after a while, I'm at home. In the past, I had to get on an aeroplane, drive to the airport, leave the car, get through this blooming security. And it took me the whole, in one day, I could not do it. Now I do it nearly every day. But since passengers, Jerry, don't travel at night, what can you do with this line? Put your freight trains on them. At that point, using the same signaling system. Okay, that's the idea of how the system, this is the level one, how the system works. This is level one, so you've got on board and something we called an EVC, which is European Vital Computer. Then on the track side, we've got other components, but according to the level, because we have level one, which uses conventional signals, which, you know, in the end is not that popular. It's something you use on secondary lines, also because it's expensive. Then we have the, let's see, again, we've got these funny things, which I call balises. Somebody in Australia, they're called transponders, but basically they can do two things. Pass the information about the aspect of the signal to the train, and if you don't have radio communication, but they do another thing which is very important. You use them to recalibrate the odometry, because, you know, there's no point in having an automatic protection system if the train doesn't know its position and its correct speed. So you process in a safe way rubbish. This is the system I like, which is the level two system, which is becoming, ironically, this system was paid with my tax, because it was developed at the expenses of the taxpayers. But is the more I work with it, the more I like it. I'm rather partial to it. I'm a partisan of this system. And so you have the EVC, which basically is the system that knows the position of the train, knows the speed, and is connected to the brakes of the train, so it can stop the train and cut the traction if needed. This system speaks with the track side through a machine, which is the radio block center, that in the end, technically, is a machine that gives something called an MA, movement authority. A movement authority is just something very simple. It's a virtual signal. So the RBC tells the EVC how long it can travel. At that point, the train can decide if it's how far is from the protected point and can decide if to apply the brakes or not. Again, as you see, the simple is rather simple because you've got EVC, you've got this computer, in the end, vital computer, which communicates by radio, balises that in this case are necessary only to recalibrate the odometer on board. And, you know, my big wish is to get rid of them, because every time somebody gets on the line, the machine destroys them, there are disruption, and so on. And, you know, we are working, what did I do? Oops. We are working on a technology based on something called GPS. I don't know if you've never heard it, but that can overcome that problem. Then, of course, we have an interlocking, because with the interlocking, you prepare the road for the train. This is level two. This was a big headache in the year 2004, because there was no way to make it work. Now it's my pride, it's the pride and joy of the Europeans. There is another level, which is level three, which it doesn't really exist at the moment, which basically can do away with the track circuits, because it's the train that tells the track side its position. The big problem of the level three is that since you don't have track circuits, if you lose a carriage, there is no track circuits or axle counter to realize that you lost the piece. So you have to fit a system on board that knows if the train is still all together or not, which, if you think about it, is very simple. But you must also think that railway companies have already got the trains, especially if they are freight trains. And, you know, if to diagnose the fact that one carriage is gone, you have to upgrade the fleet. Since the fleet is generally made of lots of machines, that is expensive, and until now, we use track circuits. In metro systems, which on the other hand are closed systems, where you just purchase the whole thing, the line, the tunnel, the platform screen doors, and the trains, they use the level three, because it's the train that detects its integrity. I talk too much. Then, okay, this is the Rome-Naples, which is the first real high-speed line in the world. Of course, if there are some French with us, or Germans, they will absolutely disagree, because they have the TGV, they have other systems, which is true. But the TGV and the ICE are what I call tubes, meaning you just have a straight track, and you send one train, one train, one train. To me, a railway line is something a bit more complex. It's not just a pipe. There are points you can get in, get out, move. So it's much harder. You know, on a TGV, I overstate it, but on a TGV line, you can use the telephone block saying, I send train, and when the train arrives at the other station, the station master says, I receive train. At that point, I say, okay, the other one can go, because it is a pipe. If I have junctions and so on, it's not that easy. With this system, you can manage it. This is what we thought when we started. So, the manufacturers, which in Italy were Alstom and Ansaldo STS, started building their Lego blocks according to this UNISIG standards. Then, when they were finished, they put the train on the high-speed line. What happened, which is an absolute irony in an interoperable system, the onboard would not be able to speak to the track side. There were lots of communication issues, because as safety engineers, we are all in the railways. What comes first is safety. So we were so obsessed by safety that we forgot something rather relevant, which I call system integration. Because, you know, as I said before, the UNISIG standard really is just a framework, is just a language. So what used to happen is that the train would, when you switch on the train, you do something we call start of mission, which is pushing a button on a display. So the train would call via a GSM phone the RBC. The RBC would reply, saying, what is your version, software version? What are your national values? And they would start chatting. Then the RBC would expect some more messages from the train that the train would not send. So the driver would find himself in the middle, if he was lucky, in the middle of station, but if not, in the middle of line, with no signal, no information, with the system stalled, not knowing what to do. And this was the big problem. At this point, I don't know how acquainted you are with our job, but you know, as a safety assessor, what I do? There is a system. A system is designed according to certain requirements. So if I am a member of the railways, if I am a safety assessor, what I do is to verify if the requirements are covered. But if you work only, you know, the way, and this system is made of many blocks, if I look at this block, you look at your block, she looks at her block, all our traceability matrix are going to be perfect, but they don't necessarily match. I know it's funny, but it's obvious. You have to integrate the systems. It's rather obvious that big multinationals know how to implement an interlocking, an RBC or an EVC. What is instead extremely unlikely is that two multinationals who are competitors speak to each other to integrate the system. At that point, and this was our role as safety assessor, we had to get these big, powerful multinationals and force them to integrate their systems. We did that on the grounds of safety, but because the system, apart from being, at that stage, the high speed was absolutely safe. The train was not moving. So we started performing something which improperly we called integration hazard analysis. Given two systems, you know, you have to integrate the two systems. So how these two systems, I mean, generally computers, as far as I know, don't read minds. They have an interface. So they exchange information through this interface. And this is the way they communicate, exactly the same way I am talking to you. My mouth is the interface, your ears is the interface, but not necessarily. Because, you know, if I say, I need a torch, you come here with a piece of wood on fire. For me, from my British side, a torch is a flashlight. So we have to integrate. We have to say, these are the interface. You have a communication protocol. First, when you say torch, or when you say something else, or wrench or spanner, what do you exactly mean? Secondly, what do you expect? What is the sequence that you expect from me? This is what we call integration hazard analysis. And we did it in a very, the grounds is, this is identify the interface, identify the messages you exchange, so the language. Then we would do something very simple. We would put the train, you know, you've got a schematic plan. We would put the train on the line and say, what can go wrong? And then what happened? What if? So me, as the track side, I would ask that to the people on board. And from this communication, the systems are integrated in terms of safety, in terms of functionality. I'm sorry to stress this again, but I take for granted that a multinational is able to develop a system that works and is possibly safe. I'm very sure that generally this system is not necessarily well integrated with the rest of the world, for the obvious reason. My job is to manufacture fridges. I don't know if you're going to put it in your kitchen or in your pantry, so you don't have this information. This is the additional information that has to come out. Let's see what's next. And what's this? I can't see. That's the... Ah, okay. So with this Rome Naples, in the end, we found a way to integrate the systems, and now you go from Rome to Naples in 1 hour with no problems. And that's chapter one of the story. Then the high-speed line evolved. We wanted to go north. To go north, in the middle of Italy, there is a chain of mountains called the Apennines. So if you want to go north, either you climb over the mountain, which is what I used to do by car, or you dig a very long hole. This part of the line, which is the line between Bologna and Florence. Sorry, I'm over here. I'm going to entangle myself in the microphone.
No fix this, no fix it.
So, sorry. The line was relatively short because it's 78 kilometers. You know, at 300 kilometers per hour, it takes more or less less than 20 minutes to go through it. The big problem is of this 78.5 kilometers, 73 are in a tunnel. A tunnel is a major concern for safety because, you know, if you have a fire, if you have an accident on a normal line, unless you are on a bridge, just open the door and get off the train if you're alive. If you are in a tunnel, it's a mousetrap. You have to evacuate the passengers in specific spots. Then, you know, can you imagine 700 people rushing out of a train in an emergency? It's not that easy. So there was the need to design the signaling in order to, in case of emergency, if, you know, the red mushroom button, whatever happens, somebody pushes that button, the trains, and generally in that tunnel there are two or three trains, have to be stopped in the right position, and especially you have to make sure that once one train has stopped in the right position, you don't have another train rushing next to it, because it's true that there are the evacuation exits, but if some passengers stray on the other track, you get a bit of a mess. So we again used the UNISIC standards using a functionality which is called cooperative movement authority shortening, which is a nightmare to implement. Why? Because the truck side, the dispatcher, calls, I mean the computer, RBC, via messages, asks the train, can you stop at that point? The train says yes or no. If it is yes, it just stops there. If it is no, the RBC says, okay, then stop ahead. And in this way, with this bi-directional communication between the truck side and the onboard, you can stop the trains in the correct evacuation points without causing too many problems to the passengers, let's put it this way. It was a completely different problem compared to the Rome-Naples. On the Rome-Naples, you just had to go as fast as possible with just making sure that where the switch were, you would not overspeed. This is a completely different kind of problems. And again, you have to, again, you know, when you build a new line, for us engineers, very simple. We say, you know, we add some features to the truck side equipment. Then the train operator would come and say, look, I've got 150 trains which are fitted with version 1.3 of the software. How do I upgrade them? Who's going to pay for that? The standard framework of regulation called interoperability standards limited the damages. I can't, in honesty, say that the train was not modified, but it was just a few lines of software and not the whole system put in the bin and upgraded. And so we got from Naples to Bologna. Then let's see where we got. This is what I just said, so you'll find the task in this line. So stop the train and use the cooperative shortened MA. I spoke a lot about all these systems and so on, system integration, system. How do you make sure in practice that these systems work? You know, in the past, all the railway people who are among us used to go at night on the line, let the train run, disconnect, stick a relay here, stick a relay there, and see what happened. We found out with the Rome-Naples that with a computer-based system, this approach is not very good for a simple reason. A computer-based system can elaborate an enormous amount of information. Does acquire information from lots of interfaces. So reproducing these conditions on the track is virtually impossible. Also because, you know, on the track you verify the system in nominal conditions. To be honest, I couldn't care less. I want to see the system in no nominal conditions. The place where you can do this kind of activities is in a lab with simulations using other computers. This has completely changed the way that the safety engineers and the designers test their machines, and the way we, safety assessors, evaluate the testing. Because if you have a laboratory where you have the object I call, let's call it the thing, the object you are evaluating, and around it, simulators or the target machines, which are even better. At that point, you can do lots of nice things because, you know, you can simulate all kind of faults. Some of you here called it fault injection. But you can simulate all kind of faults. You can see the reaction of the system. What I found out in my career is, despite there is some requirement specification, in the software, there's much more than it is written. So you can, in the lab, see what is the reaction of the system and evaluate if it is right or if it is wrong. Let's forget about compliance to the requirements and so on. But you can, among here, there will be a lot of people who are computer science engineers. They think about in terms of bits and bytes, buffers, and so on, and packets. It's true, when you develop the software, all this is very important. But when you, if you want to understand how a train works, it's much nicer to stimulate the system with a physical information. Let's simulate that the odometric error is higher than. Let's pretend this track circuit, it gets free engaged with a certain frequency, and then see what is the reaction. In this way, you can really test your system in depth, and actually, the software engineers will understand me. You know, I am basically stimulating my system in various ways. At that point, I ask myself the question, but have I stimulated the software enough? Not enough. How do I know? I do something which I call software coverage. Meaning, I perform a certain amount of tests, then I see how many paths in the software I have covered. If I have covered 100%, 100% is impossible because there's something called defensive programming. But if I've covered a high percentage of the possible paths, I don't want to get in detail because then it becomes complicated. But if I have stimulated the software hard enough, basically, I've tried every possible road in that machine. At that point, when I go on field, provided that that the field gives the same information I used in the simulator, I have no surprises. So I can work in the lab, validate my product in terms of safety, but functionality is more relevant, and install it, perform some testing on the line, and open the line without delays. Because if I do not work hard enough, if I don't do my homework in the lab, you go to the line, the system misbehaves, the engineers have no idea why the system is misbehaving, the customer, which is the infrastructure manager or the train owner, gets really annoyed because he said, you know, I paid billions of dollars for that and it's not even switching on. So, and since as a safety engineer, I have the pressure of the customer. Instead of doing my job of understanding why this is it, I have to keep the customer quiet. And I generate even more entropy. this is something they don't tell you in school. Sorry, because this is what I learned on my skin, and this is what I want to convey. So, testing, and integrating the systems and verify that your models, because, you know, we are all engineers, we make a model, and then we test the model, the reality according to our mental model. Mine is always wrong, so you have to validate the model. These are technical details. Of course, I don't know if you ever heard what an application condition is. In my car, there is an application condition which is not safety related that says that every 15,000 kilometers I should change the oil, otherwise the engine might misbehave. In the railways, we have, when I deploy my system, I have to give some safety-related application conditions, which are basically an instruction manual, where, as a manufacturer, I say what the maintenance people shall do to ensure safety, but also what I expect from the other machine. You know, I am an interlocking machine. So I open and close signals according to the status of the track circuits. If the information from the track circuits is wrong, I open the wrong signals. So as a matter of liability, which is another thing that you will learn to find out, I am the one who produces the interlocking to avoid liability problems, even if it's obvious. I write an application condition saying I process the information from the axle counters, track circuits, but that information has to be safe. If it is not safe, I can't help. It's quite obvious. This is an application condition. So when you integrate various systems, it's very obvious that you have to analyze the application conditions, this is slang, exported by other products. Otherwise, you might end up in trouble, to put it mildly. Okay. This, until now, I've given you the basic recipe, what I learned, what we learned between 2002 and 2009, more or less, 2010. Then, unexpectedly, all these blocks that we put together, the manufacturers and us, realized, and the railway, the infrastructure managers, realized they could combine them in different ways. So we have new projects which are ongoing or finished, which are based on that experience, and with the same Lego blocks, slightly modified, can be used in different situations. This is a pilot line in a place called, in northern Italy, in a place called Lombardia, and there is this pilot line where the Italian railways, for mysterious reasons, want to mix conventional traffic, so trains equipped with standard systems, with signals and so on, and ETCS systems with radio signaling. It's quite obvious. This is what happened to me in the Czech Republic. Basically, the Czech Republic had their infrastructure, which came from the Soviet Union time, they had to upgrade it. But at the same time, they couldn't say to the freight trains or the passenger train, okay, for the next 15 years, fly, do something else. So from a practical point of view, which is something that to me, as I showed, as an engineer, seems absurd because it's just money, not technology. There is the issue, while you are upgrading the system, to keep running the old system. So here on this line, we are mixing conventional traffic with, conventional signaling equipment with high speed. And we have mixed traffic between conventional trains, and I don't want to, high speed trains is wrong because they are all traveling at the same speed, more or less. But with mixed signaling, one train uses one signaling system, another train uses another signaling system. Here, there are some, you know, in theory, it's quite simple. You know, when the track circuit is engaged, you can't put another train on top of it. It's, from the logical point of view, it's easy. But there are some technological challenges because, as I showed you before, for instance, there are balises. If I am an ETCS train, I use the balise only to recalibrate my odometry. If I am a level one train, I use the balise to know what is the aspect of the signal. These messages, which I call telegrams, are read. The balise is always the same. The balise doesn't know what train is going to come on top of it. So it's transmitting always the same message. What happens is that the train, the onboard, must be able to discriminate between what is relevant and what is not relevant. And there's an extra difficulty. Since I am designing the new ETCS EVCs, I can put this feature in the software of the new trains to discard part of the message which is related to the conventional signaling. What about the old trains? Again, the train owner says, no, I will, this time, my dear Italian railways, I'm not going to pay for that. So you have to use existing features of the existing trains so that the train automatically discards the extra information it doesn't need. Now, I'm making the thing funny, but I can tell you, it's complex. Because you must know the two systems very well. And this is something that sooner or later is going to happen in this country. Because you will have to upgrade, despite what they say. Then what shall we do? OK. This is what I was saying. So in the end, when you get the presentation, you will have the headlines of what I said. OK. This is, you know, some has to be managed with operational procedures, some technical problem. Most of things, we must make an analysis of known intrusivity of one system to the other. Because on the other hand, there is another, I just remembered it. Some trains are equipped to run on conventional lines or high-speed lines, so they have on board a double system. Of course, only one of these systems is connected to the brakes. You must make sure that the signaling system, which is sleeping at the moment in the train, doesn't intrude with the functions of the other. It's not rocket science. In fact, it's train science. But this has to be managed and has to be structured. Then suddenly, one day, something else happened. In Australia is a big supplier of iron ore to China. And this iron ore is extracted from mines. And here we're getting a bit more towards the American application. In mines, in the middle of nowhere in the desert, and carried by train, freight trains, 3-4 kilometers long, to the coast where the train, the iron ore, gets shipped to China to make steel. This company, which is called Rio Tinto, which is one of the big ones, since this line is 400 kilometers, is absolutely in the middle of nowhere, has to carry train drivers, spares, maintenance crews by helicopter to the line, and so on. If there is even the train drivers sleep in Perth, which is a city, I think, 1,000 kilometers away from the line. So everything has to be lifted and so on. They decided to have a driverless train, which is the solution to the problem. I mean, they want to have as little infrastructure as possible. And the minimum is two tracks. you can't do without that. But they didn't want to have balises, they didn't want to have communication networks via cable, and possibly they didn't want to have drivers. So, an Italian multinational won the tender and involved us in this big trouble, involved us in the assessment. Again, here these Lego bricks of ETCS came useful because radio communication. So you would use the radio communication. You would not use the track circuits because you have to implement the function on the train to make sure the train is not broken. And then, as in the end, it's very common in metro systems, no driver. You have a non-safety related equipment that throttles up and down and slows, accelerates, and so on. It's not safety related. Why? You have a vital system that oversees what is going on. So if the driver, whether it's a computer or a man, makes a mistake, the ATP kicks in. I forgot the point. there's another basic point in this project, because in the end it was not so hard. We speak generally about risk assessment. If we think about a conventional railway, what is the risk? Killing the passengers or hitting cars at level crossings? If you are in Australia, running over a couple of kangaroos every now and then is not regarded as such a big deal. So, the concept, but this is another important thing, the concept of safety is relative, depends what for and so on. On the other hand, for Rio Tinto, for me, if there is a malfunction in the whole chain, what is the safe reaction? Stopping the train, emergency braking. Emergency braking is quite tough on the train. The wheels don't like it. And especially if you are a very long train, very heavily laden, the naughty back carriages have got this habit of derailing. This, for Rio Tinto, is a hazard. Of course, it's not a hazard in our term, because it doesn't hurt somebody. But it means having to put the train back on the rail, block the line, and especially not provide revenue, because each train was $1.5 million of Australian dollars, of iron. So if the train is derailed, so we had to use these blocks in a different way to ensure safety. And the safety was, let's make sure that when the train has to stop, it stops. But it should not stop that hard. And the difficulty is here having too much what is my bread and butter, which are the vital system, which is signaling system, with the brakes. The brakes of the train is something, brakes have existed since the Wild West and haven't changed much. So you have to make a very effective but simple system safely. That it was the challenge. And the train is working. What's next? Okay, then after Rio Tinto, another Australian mining company said, you know, we want to do the same, but we don't want to have track circuits. We don't want to have balises. We are operating in the middle of the desert. You know, what happened? This is Australia is a disaster-prone country. So you have typhoons, sandstorms, all kinds of things that damage the ground equipment. They don't want to have the ground balises to recalibrate the odometry, all these kinds of things. The idea, as usual, is very simple. Why do we need a recalibration? We use the GPS. We use the GPS to localize the train. The idea is brilliant. The idea is brilliant. The problem is that the GPS is not designed for trains. It's designed to ensure a certain level of safety for our car navigators, and the safety is nil, but especially the GPS system is certified for aeronautical standards. Basically, the GPS system has to ensure a safe and reliable operation for the last 127 seconds of the flight when you are approaching to landing. Because that is the time slot when the plane needs to know rather accurately how high it is and where, if it's aligned with the... But it's 120 seconds. Airports are generally in flat places, so there are no billiards effects of reflection of radio waves. So we have to... This had to be adapted to the train. And this is what is happening on this project. The solution is very banal. You use the GPS system, the GPS signal, which gives you two information, position and the reliability of the position, the window of accuracy. Since the satellite is not a safety-related machine, so the software and the hardware on the satellite up there is not really compliant to what for me are relevant standards. So basically, if there is a fault in the satellite being designed for an aeroplane, tries to feed you information even if it's wrong, because the aeroplane must know where it is. And since if you were here, after 1 second, it's very likely that you've gone ahead at the same speed, not that you have gone back 300 miles. This doesn't work with trains. So we use a simple technique, and then I'm finished. We use a base station that knows where it is. And so if you get, if my base station moves of more than a certain distance, you tell to the train, don't trust the signal. Again, this was all done with the ETCS blocks. So we changed only the way on the train, the odometric system gets the recalibration information from a piece of equipment called BTM, which is an antenna under the train that feeds information to the odometer. We hacked into that system, meaning we connected that interface, not to the BTM, but to another piece of equipment that gives similar information. And we didn't have to modify the whole thing. It's quite a nice idea, isn't it? Then I think, okay, that's the Roy Hill. This is exactly what I said, the line. I survived. I'm finished. And I was, okay, just 4 minutes late. Again, I wanted to give an idea of what real life is for a safety assessor, for somebody, for a safety engineer, what is life is for the infrastructure manager and for people who make these systems. All the rest, you come to our university course and we'll teach it to you, all the technical details. Then, if you have any questions, please don't be shy and ask.
And we do have time for some questions, so are there? There's at least one from online that I'll ask. Oh, didn't see your hand up, sorry.
At the beginning, you mentioned the level 3 system where you can remove the track circuits. Would you have an extra system in place to look for rail breaks, or is that not a...
I didn't understand. To look for what?
For broken rails? Or is that not an issue in...
Have you got a second question? I mean... I must give you an answer.
Well, let me rephrase the question.
Yeah.
Are there track circuits in place on your
system? Again, I didn't hear the question.
Are there track circuits in place? Do the rails have a track circuit on them? We were discussing this yesterday.
Yes. There are, I mean, on the high, unless you are level 3, you need track circuits, axle counters. On the high-speed line in Italy, we have something called audio frequency track circuits, because the Italian railways don't like to have the insulation between two tracks, because you know what happens every now and then. The insulation goes... So, we have these track circuits. To be honest, in the railways, generally the track circuits are used also to detect the fact that the rail can break. That, in my opinion, is a misuse of the system, because the track circuit or an axle counter is designed to understand if a train is in position or not. So my opinion is that there is probably a better technological solution to detect the breakage of the rail. In my country, trains, you know, you have freight trains, so you probably have very different problems because they are heavy. In my country, generally the problem is not the breakage of the rail. And anyway, there is a maintenance schedule. So the fatigue of the rail is well modeled, you should know when to go and look for cracks and fractures. And so I would say that the maintenance is what should sort out the problem. In my country, the problem is when you have joints between the tracks. At that point, in Italy, they invented a very simple machine, a very simple system, a micro switch. The two sides are, imagine having a track. You've got the isolated joint, and underneath there is the plate with the bolts, let's say. That is the weak point in my railway, that because nobody inspects the thing. So the bolts start getting loose, and there's all very interesting things happen. They do something very simple. They glue this micro switch to one side and the other side of the joint. It's, in the end, is epoxy resin. And, you know, it's two contacts. if the joint gets loose, it doesn't break. It's just that the bolts, the hole starts, instead of a circle, becomes an ellipse. So it starts, I don't know how to say it in English, but I mean, there is some plane. At that point, when the joint tends to open a little bit, the microswitch opens, the microswitch is connected to the track circuit, and the track circuit becomes occupied. Or otherwise, this microswitch is led with the wire to a control center, and you know if that joint is damaged or not. Of course, the design of the microswitch has to be, it's a simple mechanical design. Once the circuit is open, there is no way you can close it back. There is a kind of piece, a dog, that moves, and so it prevents. This way, you detect the fracture of the joint.
We have another question from online, one of the online recipients, and the question is, does level 3 in your system have moving block?
I can say yes and no. In theory, yes. In real life, no, because the train owners do not want to upgrade the trains with the fail-safe way to determine the braking of the train. So there is no level 3. Unless we are on a metro system where, of course, you have the moving block. But it's not really a technological problem. It's a business problem. You have one.
The first question is that you mentioned that in Australia you use the satellite GPS location method. But when the GPS system for the tunnels, because tunnels separate the signal, so.
Yes. How do you do it?
Yeah,
how do you do it? You, first, in an Australian desert, there are no tunnels. That's the real answer. Mm. So we don't have this problem. In the experimental line we have in Italy, there are several ideas. You can use a slotted cable that leaks the GPS signal through the tunnel, but otherwise there is a very simple way. You just use balises to recalibrate.
GSM.
Yeah. GSM. It's, but again, this, in a pragmatical world, you know, I don't want to offend the university, but sometimes, at the moment, satellite localization is not safe enough. So, of course, you think and design system that in the future will give the intended safety integrity level. But to solve the problem I have today in a tunnel, there is only one way. Put some balises so that you mitigate this kind of problem.
Okay. The second question is about what is your standard, your level 3 with TSI, for example, technical specification interoperability? What is the relationship?
If you, a TSI, state something very simple.
Very simple.
Very simple, in terms of signaling. You have to stick to the UNISIG standards that allow you to have 3 levels, level 1, level 2, level 3. Then, of course, there are all the other TSI regarding, for instance, something obvious, the gauge, because the gauge has to be possibly very similar. The shape of the wheels, the lots of things regarding the rolling stock. But in terms of TSI, the TSI say you have to stick to Unisig 0.26, 3.3, I never know which one is the last version, 3.3.0, I think. That defines what are the operation, what is the standard for level 1, 2, and 3.
Okay, thank you.
I want to say another, while you go, I want to say, ironically, this, the technology I described today is a technology that was born and implemented for the first time in Europe and in Italy. What surprised me that who fully, because in Europe, we are still squabbling. I've made the TGV, I spent 30 million euros, I don't want to upgrade my system. I've got the ITSE, this is the best system in the world, I don't want to change it. Who understood perfectly well the power of ETCS and unleashed all that power is the Public Republic of China. Who understood clearly this idea. The Chinese are very practical people. If they find a standard solution that is applicable in many situations, they immediately adopt it. This is why I don't like this urban landscape in China, because all the buildings are exactly the same. But in terms of trains, they use this technology. They have 50,000 kilometers of high reliability, high-speed lines, absolutely standardized. But basically, they understood the game of the Lego blocks. You've got something that technically I call interoperability component, which is the bit, the onboard system, the balise that sends a message in a certain way, the RBC, they use these Lego blocks. Here and there, they change the software, the logic, according to their needs, and it's brilliant. And they are destroying us because they've learned how to do it. They learned how the CENELEC standards, Chinese are brilliant students. Before opening their mouth, they study, study, and study. Once they're sure, they come out with their solution. At this point, the railway technology in China is fully mature, and China is already going in different countries, in UK first, because the British don't like to spend money, so if you give them a good deal, they will take it. But I'm sure they're already coming to the United States, and so on. Good for them. But again, and this is my personal opinion, I think that a bit of competition every now and then helps. So people from the West should wake up a little bit, but this is my opinion.
I think we'll take one more question from Bradford, and then we need to wrap it up.
Is there an accepted protocol across all of Europe of what to do to keep trains moving in the event of a natural disaster, such as a solar flare that completely takes out the ability of GPS communication?
To avoid the answer, I would ask the experts about risk assessment. What is the probability of a natural disaster and what is the consequence? Of course, I live in Italy. In Italy, we have a few volcanoes, which, you know, when they go off, can be rather damaging to the railways. But we do not have any detection system for that. Why? Because the Italian National Safety Authority decided that the probability of an event of that scale is improbable. So we can accept the idea of losing one train. Every, you know, last time there was a big bang was the Vesuvius in the Roman times. So we accept to lose a train every 2,000 years, but we regard this as not relevant. It's very, and this is, you are saying something very important. In a country like Japan, where earthquakes are every day's problem, they have a system that detects, I am not a geologist, so I don't know S wave, P waves, but there are some waves that comes before the earthquake. When these waves are detected, the whole system, train system in Japan stops. The evidence that it works was given, unfortunately, a few years ago, that no Shinkansen had an accident, and the trains that got washed away during the tsunami were not moving. It was not enough, but from the signaling point of view, what was possible to do was done. Again, to give you an answer, is that since Europe can have all kind of different natural disasters, you can't not set a standard which is the same. So, you know, in the Low Countries, probably the damage of a dam and washing away, on the Alps, is rather unlikely. So you can't standardize that. And this is why you have risk acceptance authorities that tell you, I call them the Pope. The Pope has to tell you what is wrong. This is an axiom. You can't say what is right and what is wrong. You can have an opinion, but I'm sure in this room we have 150 different opinions about things. So there is the Pope that says what is right, the Pope of the railways that says what is right and what is wrong.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the patience.